Hello everyone, myself Dr. M.SRUJAN Kumar. My education background is pharmacy. Today's topic is surgical dressings. First, let us move on to the introduction to surgical dressing. So we will define the definition of dressing first. A dressing is a sterile pad or compress. So dressing is a sterile pad or compress. Why we will use this terminology called as compress? Any dressing that is applied to the affected area, it will be applied with some moderate pressure. Okay, that's the reason dressing is a sterile pad or compress applied to a wound. What is the purpose of applying dressing to the affected area? In order to promote healing and to protect the wound from further harm. A dressing is designed to be in direct contact with the wound as distinguished from a bandage, which is most often used to hold a dressing in place. Here there is something to understand the difference between a dressing and a bandage. Okay, dressing is the one which will be in direct contact with the wound. Okay, when compared to the bandage is the one which will most often used to hold a dressing in place. This is the purpose of bandage. Okay, most oftenly bandage is used to hold a dressing in place. Okay, so here there is a clause. So we said most oftenly, sometimes the bandage may be in direct contact with the wound. Okay, it is in terms of your medicated bandages. Medicated bandages are the one which will be in direct contact with the wound. But normally when we look for the difference between a dressing and a bandage, dressing is the one which will be in primary contact with the wound and bandage is the one which will hold the dressing in place. So many modern dressings are self-adhesive. Whatever modern dressings that are available in the market are self-adhesive. Okay, self-adhesive means nothing but dressing itself will be having an adhesive layer. Okay, no need to take some extra adhesive plasters to put something onto the dressing. Already, because they are called themselves as a self-adhesive dressings. A dressing can have number of purposes, okay, depending on the type, severity and position of the wound. Okay, so not only one purpose to promote healing, there are number of purposes for the dressing. Okay, and any dressing, any surgical dressing, the purpose depends upon the type of wound, severity of the wound and position of the wound. Okay, although all purposes are focused on promoting recovery and protecting from further harm, at the end of the day the purpose of dressing is to promote recovery and protecting from further harm. Okay, whatever might be the wound type, whatever might be the depth of severity, whatever might be the position, okay, the final goal of the dressing is that to promote recovery and to protect from further harm. We'll move on to the next slide. Now here in this slide we will discuss about what are the key purposes of a dressing are. Okay, so we will discuss one by one. The first key purpose of dressing is stem bleeding. Okay, the key purpose of dressing is stem bleeding. So to help to seal the wound, to expedite the clotting process. Okay, the first key purpose of the dressing is to avoid stem bleeding. Okay, how it will avoid stem bleeding? It will seal the wound, okay, to expedite the clotting process. It will seal the wound in such a way that the clotting will stop at the particular point. Okay, next, protection from infection. Next key purpose is protection from infection. So a surgical dressing is applied to the affected area to defend the wound against germs and mechanical damage. In order to defend against germs and in order to protect your wound from mechanical damage. This is the next key purpose of your surgical dressing. Next, to absorb exudate. Exudate is nothing but discharges from your wound are nothing but called as exudates. It might be a blood discharge, it might be a pus discharge, it might be a water discharge. Okay, so this surgical dressing help you to absorb the exudate coming from the wound. So how it will help you to absorb? To soak up blood, plasma and other fluids exuded from the wound, containing it them in one place and preventing maceration. So when it absorbs all these discharges from the wound, Okay, in one way it will help in preventing maceration. Maceration is nothing but degradation of your skin layer. Degradation of your skin layer. Okay, that is nothing but maceration. Okay, so when a particular part of your body get affected, ultimately that particular wound causing area will start oozing the exudates. When you don't stop that exudates, oozing the exudates, ultimately it will result in maceration of the skin. Okay, losing the skin loses its strength and start degrading. Okay, in order to prevent that maceration, it is important for a dressing to absorb the exudates from the wound. Okay, next key purpose is ease the pain. Okay, it will help you to ease the pain. Okay, either by medicated analgesic effect, compression, or simply preventing pain from further trauma. Okay, how your surgical dressing will ease the pain? Either you can offer any medicated dressings, medicated surgical dressing, where in that medicated surgical dressing it will contain some analgesic agent. With this analgesic agent, it will show the it. What do you mean by analgesic? To reduce the pain. Okay, it will ease the pain. Okay, there are some other purposes. Okay, to ease the pain. By applying compression onto that affected area also, you can get rid of the pain, and simply preventing pain from further trauma. Okay, in order to provide in, because as the wound get advanced, ultimately the pain will be more. Okay, in order to prevent that particular trauma and all, you can use your surgical dressing. This is another key purpose. Next, debride the wound. Next key purpose is debride the wound. What it is? To remove slog and foreign objects from the wound to expedite healing. Okay, so debride the wound is nothing but to remove any other slog and foreign objects from the wound will help you to expedite the healing. And next, to reduce psychological stress. Okay, what do you mean by to reduce psychological stress? To obscure the healing wound from the view of the patient and others. Okay, so when the wound is open and it is not properly dressed and it is not properly packed with the gauze or something like that, ultimately keeping on seeing that wound, ultimately it will build up the psychological stress in our body. Okay, in order to avoid the psychological stress, this surgical dressing it will mimic the wound and just it will cover the wound in such a way that the patient will not be viewing all the time the wound and just feeling that, array, what happened exactly, when, what is the condition of my wound. So this is some kind of psychological feeling. Always any human being will produce some actions towards the wound. Okay, so this is about your key purposes of a dressing. Yeah, next we will move on to what are the different types of surgical dressings. Next we will move on to the session called as types of surgical dressings. So based upon the contact of your dressing with the wound or affected area, the surgical dressings are divided into two types: primary dressing, secondary dressing. Primary dressing, secondary dressing. Primary dressing is the one, a surgical dressing that is in direct contact with the wound. Primary dressings are the one that are in direct contact with the wound. Secondary dressings are the one which are placed onto your primary dressing, that are not in direct contact with your wound. This is the difference between a primary and secondary dressings. There are some secondary dressings which also access primary as well as secondary. Okay, and next classification is based upon the interaction of the surgical dressings with your wound. Okay, they are divided into three types. The first type is passive products. The examples which cover under your passive products are gauze, lint, adhesive bandages, plasters, and cotton wool. Okay, these are your passive products. Okay, so these passive products acts as an example for your secondary dressing also. Okay, next comes your interactive products. Interactive products are the products which comes under the classification of your primary dressings. Okay, interactive products are the products which directly comes in contact with your wound or affected area. Yeah, the first type of interactive products. Interactive products again divided into some different types. The first type is semi-permeable film dressing. Semi-permeable film dressing. Okay. The chemical agent that is present in this semi-permeable film dressing is, instead of calling it as a chemical agent, you can call it as a polymer. The polymer that is present in semi-permeable film dressing is polyurethane. Polyurethane. When this semi-permeable film dressing applied onto the affected area, okay, it will form a thin transparent film on the wound or affected area. It will form what? Thin transparent film on the wound or affected area. Okay. The thing that is responsible for the formation of thin transparent film is your polyurethane. The polymer that is responsible for the formation of thin transparent film is your polyurethane. Okay, this semi-permeable film dressing will help for the exchange of your gases like your oxygen and CO2. For the exchange of the gases like your oxygen and CO2. Oxygen and CO2 will move in and out of your wound through this semi-permeable film dressing. This is the first type that comes under the category of interactive products. The next type is semi-permeable foam dressing. Semi-permeable foam dressing. And here the polymer that is responsible for the formation of this semi-permeable foam dressing is silicone. The polymer that is responsible for the formation of this semi-permeable foam dressing is silicone. Here there is an interesting thing here. Silicone consists of two layers. One is hydrophilic layer. Okay, and the other one is hydrophobic layer. Hydrophilic layer is the layer that will be in intact with your wound. Okay, hydrophilic layer will be facing towards your wound. And hydrophobic layer is the layer that is present outside of your hydrophilic layer. It is exposed outside. Okay, so hydrophilic layer is faced inwards and your hydrophobic layer is faced outwards. Okay, this is how you need to imagine. Okay, hydrophilic layer will help you to absorb the exudates that are coming from your wound. Okay, and it will also help you to maintain moisture inside the wound. Okay, and hydrophobic layer is the layer which will not allow any sort of water or any sort of things to enter inside the wound. Okay, it also help you to protect from mechanical damage. Hydrophobic layer will help you to mechanical damage. As we know that hydrophilic is a water loving layer and hydrophobic is the water hating layer. So that's the reason hydrophobic layer will be placed outside and hydrophilic layer will be placed inside. Okay, the activity of hydrophilic layer is that as it is a water loving, whatever exudates that comes from the wound, it will absorb the exudates. Okay, and the role of hydrophobic layer is that it will protect from environmental damage. Next, hydrogel dressing. Next type that comes under the category of your interactive product is hydrogel dressing. So, hydrogel dressing is made up of two synthetic polymers. Okay, one is methacrylate, the other one is polyvinyl pyrrolidine. Okay, hydrogel dressing is made up of two synthetic polymers. One is methacrylate and polyvinyl pyrrolidine. The polymers that are responsible for the preparation of your hydrogel dressing are methacrylate and polyvinyl pyrrolidine. Okay, and coming to the nature of this hydrogel dressing, these hydrogel dressings will be having high water content. As they are having high water content, they provide enough moisture and cooling effect for the wound. As they contain high water content, hydrogel, nothing but gel containing water. Okay, by the name itself, we can say that it is a gel containing water. As it contains more amount of water, it is rich in water content. So, this water content will help you to produce the moisture to the wound and at the same time, it will produce the cooling effect for the wound. Okay, this hydrogel dressing is easy to remove from the wound without causing any damage. So, it is unlike your gauzes, cotton and all, some amount of cotton or gauze will just adhere to your wound. So, while removing it from the wound, it will be a difficult task. But in the case of hydrogel dressing, as it is having high water content and moisture is maintained inside, it is easy to remove from the wound without causing any damage. Okay, this is the third type of your interactive products. Yeah, we will move on to the next one. Fourth type that comes under the category of interactive products. That is hydrocolloid dressing. The next one is hydrocolloid dressing. So this dressing also, it consists of two layers. Okay. Like your second type of dressing. Okay. That is semi-permeable foam dressing. That also contains two types of layers. Inner and outer. Inner is hydrophilic and outer is hydrophobic. Here also your hydrocolloid dressing consists of two layers. Inner is colloidal layer, the outer is waterproof layer. Waterproof layer means nothing but, in another words, we can say it is an hydrophobic layer. Okay, what is meant by hydrophobic? Water hating. Waterproof layer and water hating layer is both are the one and the same. So inner is colloidal layer and the outer is waterproof layer. So it contains gel forming agents such as carboxy methyl cellulose, gelatin and pectin. Okay, the polymers that are present in your hydrocolloid dressings are carboxy methyl cellulose, gelatin and pectin. These three ingredients are gel forming agents. Okay, the polymers that are responsible for the preparation of your hydrocolloid dressing are carboxy methyl cellulose, gelatin and pectin. These three ingredients are gel forming agents. When the dressing is in contact with the wound, the wound discharge are retained to form gel, which provides moist environment for wound healing. So what is the mechanism involved in hydrocolloid dressing? So when this dressing is in intact with your wound or in contact with your wound, okay, the wound discharge, whatever the wound exudate, whatever that comes from the wound, it will be taken up by the gel. Okay, it will be retained in the gel, thereby it will provide moist environment, which will be helpful for wound healing. Okay, so we know that any wound will produce exudates. That exudates will be retained in the gel. Okay, so this gel will provide moist environment, thereby it will produce what? Wound healing. Okay, next, it also protects the wound from, not only wound healing aspects, it also protects the wound from bacterial contamination. How it will protect wound from bacterial contamination? We know that by absorbing the wound discharge, and it digests the necrotic tissues. Necrotic, nothing but any damaged cells or damaged tissues, okay, that will be digested by hydrocolloid dressing. Okay, next fifth type of dressing that comes under the category of interactive products, alginate dressing. This type of dressing is made up of either sodium or calcium salt of alginic acid. Okay, so how the alginate dressing is made? It is made either with a sodium or calcium salt of alginic acid. These dressings can absorb high amount of discharge from the wound. Okay, this alginate dressing also has the capability of absorbing high amount of discharge from the wound. And here the mechanism involved in alginate dressing is very interesting. The ions present in the dressing can interact with blood to produce a film that protects the wound from bacterial contamination. As we said that alginate dressings are prepared from the sodium or calcium salts of alginic acid. That means that this particular alginate dressings will contain what? Ions. So these ions, what they will do, you know, these ions will interact with the blood. Okay, so that is present in the dressing. Where ions will be present? Ions present in the dressing will interact with the blood. It will form a film. This particular film will protect the wound from bacterial contamination. This is how your alginate dressings will work. Very interesting, right? Yeah, next one. Bioactive dressing. Next category, which comes under interactive products, is bioactive. So advancements in understanding of wounds have commanded biomedical innovations in the treatment of acute, chronic and other type of wounds. So if you go to your ages, in ages we used to have only normal type of surgical dressings like cotton, gauzes and all. But as there is an advancement in understanding of wounds, when we know the mechanism involved in wounds, how the wound will look like, what are the physiological conditions of your wound, okay, and apart from that, when we understand what is the pathological condition of the wound, what is the severity and what is about your necrosis. When we understand all these things, ultimately what it will lead to, some biomedical innovations, okay, keeping in the advancement of research in order to invent some new to surgical dressings, okay. Because if you can see the present market, we have n number of surgical dressings, okay. Some surgical dressings will be shocking enough, like they are self adhesive, and there are some surgical dressings examples like medicated bandages, okay. You can view it in my YouTube channel, a session on medicated bandages. It's very interesting, okay. A bandage will be there, inside that all your medicaments will be present, incorporated inside that. It will be used in the treatment of eczema and dermatitis, okay. These particular biomedical innovations has been led to an advancement, and it lead to the treatment of acute, chronic and other type of wounds. So many biologics here, I want to place an example, ma. Have you heard about absorbable gelatin sponge? This also you can view under my YouTube channel. There is a session on absorbable gelatin sponge. It is a brand name is gel foam. It's a very interesting topic. That is also an advancement in treating acute, chronic and other type of wounds. So many biologics, skin substitutes, biomembranes and scaffolds have been developed to facilitate wound healing through various mechanisms. There are many things invented, like your biologics, advancement in biologics, advancement in skin substitutes, okay, advancements in biomembranes and scaffolds. Scaffolds are something used after during your surgical procedures. Scaffolds are the one which is used during your surgical procedures. So all these things have been developed to facilitate what? Wound healing through various mechanisms. This is about your bioactive products. Yeah, next we will move on to types of surgical dressings. There are many number of surgical dressings that are present in the market. So definitely we need to have classification of these surgical dressings. So the first surgical dressings classification we have done with primary and secondary. Secondary surgical dressings we have dealt with passive products, interactive products and bioactive products. And the third type of classification we are going to talk about, how to classify different types of surgical dressings that are present in the market, like cotton, gauges, medicated bandages, gelatin sponges, this, that and all, blah blah. So how to classify all these things? So here we are having a broad classification. These surgical dressings have been divided into five types: fibers, fabrics, bandages, self-adhesive plasters, compound dressings. They are divided into five types: fibers, fabrics, bandages, self-adhesive plasters, compound dressing. So we'll see one by one. So what do you mean by fibers? So cotton is by far the most useful fiber for surgical dressings, okay, the most affordable one and the most cost effective one, and the first seen surgical dressing is your cotton fibers, okay. But regenerated cellulose, wood fibers and wool are also used. Apart from cotton, there is an advancement in your fibers also. So you can come across like regenerated cellulose, wood fibers and wool are also used. So coming to the classification of fibers, these fibers are again divided into four types. Cotton fibers, rayon fibers, wood cellulose fibers, wool fibers. So these cotton fibers again divided into two types: unmedicated cotton fibers, medicated cotton fibers, unmedicated and medicated. So unmedicated example is absorbent cotton wool, which we use regularly, and medicated cotton wool are capsicum cotton wool, okay. So this medicated cotton wool will be used in surgical procedures, okay. Especially it will not be used a day-to-day purpose, okay. They will be used in hospitals and in nursing homes and all, okay. Next fiber is rayon type of fibers. These are again divided into two types: lustrous and matte type. Lustrous is a regenerated cellulose. It is called as matte type. Delustered regenerated cellulose. The examples for your rayon type of fibers are absorbent viscose wadding various fabrics. Absorbent viscose wadding various fabrics. Okay. Next type of fiber, wood cellulose. Wood cellulose fibers. The example is cellulose wadding. The example is cellulose wadding. And next type of fiber is wool fibers. Wool fibers. Example is animal wool chiropody. Animal wool chiropody. This is a classification about your different types of fibers and their examples. Next, we will move on to fabrics. Next, we'll move on to fabrics. Next classification is fabrics. So, fabrics will be having multiple purposes. Okay, the one purpose is fabrics acts as fillers, substance used to dress a fabric to give it a desired finish or appearance. Fabrics are the one, okay, that are comes under the category of surgical dressings. They help you to dress a fabric to give a desired finish or appearance. Okay, these fabrics are divided into two types: non-impregnated, impregnated. Non-impregnated, impregnated. What is the difference between non-impregnated and impregnated? So impregnated is the one when your fabric is mixed with some oily substance or some waxy substance. Non-impregnated are plain fabrics. Okay, this non-impregnated are again divided into two types: plain cotton, plain with raised nap cotton. Plain cotton, plain with raised nap cotton. This plain cotton fabric again divided into three types. Unbleached calico, gauzes, muslin type. Okay. This unbleached calico, example is unbleached calico cotton. And gauzes are divided into two types: ordinary gauze and X-ray detectable gauze. Okay, the examples for your ordinary and X-ray detectable gauzes are absorbent cotton gauze, absorbent ribbon gauze, gauze pad. Okay, coming to the other type of non-impregnated, plain with raised nap cotton. The example is lint. The lint are again divided into two types: unmedicated and medicated. Unmedicated example is absorbent lint. And medicated example is effluvine lint. Okay. Coming to the impregnated type of fabrics, again divided into two types: plain and linotype. Plain, example silk, that is example is oil silk, and linotype, the fabric might be made from cotton, rayon or both, and example is paraffin gauze resin. I told you that impregnated is nothing but when your fabric is treated with oil or waxy like substance. Okay, so the plain silk is oil silk example, and for your linotype, fabric prepared from cotton, rayon or both, is your paraffin gauze dressing. That's all about your fabric classification. Next, coming to the bandages. A bandage is a piece of material used either to support a medical device such as dressing or splint. What is the purpose of bandage? To support a medical device such as dressing or splint, or on its own, it also provides support. Okay. So apart from supporting your medical dressing, on its own also, it will support the part of your body. And there is a very important purpose of your bandage is that it will restrict the movement of a part of the body. Example, you can take example as a creep bandage. Okay, it will restrict the movement of the part of your body. These bandages are again divided into four types. Non-elastic bandages, elastic bandages, impregnated bandages, adhesive bandages. non-elastic, elastic, impregnated, adhesive. Non-elastic bandages are divided into three types. Non-elastic bandages are divided into three types. Cotton unbleached calico. Example is triangular calico bandage. Triangular calico bandage. All these types of bandages you will come across in orthopedic hospitals. Okay, based upon the position of the wound, they are going to prescribe this. The different types of bandages. Okay, so next, cotton heavy wave bandage. Example is open wave bandage. Open wave bandage. And double cotton and winding wool. Example is dometi bandage. Dometi bandage. The example for your third category of your non-elastic bandage is dometi bandage. Next, coming to the next category, elastic bandages. Elastic bandages. The three types of elastic bandages: elasticity produced by twisting threads, elasticity produced by twisting threads, elasticity produced by rubber threads, elasticity produced by rubber threads, elasticity produced by crimping. It's very interesting, right? We are just focused on what type of bandage the doctor has been prescribed to us, physician has been prescribed to us. We are never worried about what is the mechanism used in the preparation of these bandages. Okay, there is a bandage called the elasticity towards the bandage produced by twisting threads. Next, elasticity produced by rubber threads. Elasticity produced by crimping. So, elasticity produced by twisting threads, examples are crepe bandage, cotton crepe bandage, cotton stretch bandage. Crepe bandage, cotton crepe bandage, cotton stretch bandage. Next, elasticity produced by rubber threads, examples are cotton and rubber elastic bandage, cotton and rubber elastic bandage, cotton and rubber elastic net bandage, cotton and rubber elastic net bandage. And elasticity produced by crimping, example is cotton conforming bandage, cotton conforming bandage. Next comes your impregnated bandage. Impregnated bandage. Impregnating is nothing but mixing with some substance. Okay. In the last slide, we have discussed about your paraffin and oil. Okay. Here we will know about what are the impregnated substances used. Okay. The first example is plaster of Paris bandage. Plaster of Paris bandage. POP bandage. Next, zinc paste bandage. Bandage impregnated with zinc paste. Bandage impregnated with plaster of Paris. Next, bandage impregnated with zinc paste and coal tar. Zinc paste and coal tar bandage. Bandage impregnated with zinc paste and ichthamol bandage. Okay, these impregnated bandages are also called as what? Medicated bandages. Impregnated bandages are also called as medicated bandages. Make a note on this. Okay. There is a separate topic to be studied called as medicated bandages. So, medicated bandages are nothing but impregnated bandage. Already there is a bandage. Onto that bandage, you are going to put some substance onto that. That is nothing but impregnating a substance onto the bandage. Next comes your adhesive bandages. Adhesive bandages. They are divided into two types. Lead-based adhesive bandage. Self-adhesive bandage. Lead-based adhesive bandage. Self-adhesive bandage. So, lead-based adhesive bandage example is diachylon elastic bandage, diachylon elastic bandage, and your self-adhesive bandage is zinc oxide elastic self-adhesive bandage, zinc oxide elastic self-adhesive bandage. Clear? That's all about your bandage. Yeah, we'll move on to the next type of category of your surgical dressing called as self-adhesive plasters. Self-adhesive plasters. So what are these? These consists of self-adhesive mass spread on a supporting material that may be plain or elastic or plastic. Okay, what are the self-adhesive plasters? You will be having a supporting material. That supporting material is made up of either cloth, plain cloth, or elastic cloth or plastic film. Onto that, you are going to spread what? Adhesive mass should be spread onto the supporting material. That forms your self-adhesive plasters. Okay, what are self-adhesive plasters? You will be having a supporting material. That supporting material will be made from either plain cloth or elastic cloth or plastic film. Onto that, you need to spread what? Your self-adhesive mask to be spread on that. Thereby, your self-adhesive plasters manufacturing is ready. Okay. So, under plain cloth self-adhesive plasters, examples are Belladonna self-adhesive plaster. These are medicated self-adhesive plasters. Belladonna self-adhesive plaster, salicylic acid self-adhesive plaster, zinc oxide self-adhesive plaster. Belladonna self-adhesive plaster, salicylic acid self-adhesive plasters, zinc oxide self-adhesive plasters. Next, elastic cloth plasters. Examples are extension plaster, and next example, zinc oxide elastic self-adhesive plaster. Zinc oxide elastic self-adhesive plaster. And next, plastic film. Adhesive plasters made from plastic film. Examples, perforated plastic self-adhesive plaster, waterproof plastic self-adhesive plaster, next, waterproof microporous plastic self-adhesive plaster, waterproof microporous plastic self-adhesive plaster. This is everything about your self-adhesive plasters and their classification. Next, last category of your surgical dressing is compound dressing. Compound dressing. Okay. So, compound dressing means nothing but mixing up your surgical dressings. Okay. Compound dressing. Combination. Compound dressings are nothing but combination of your dressing. The first, it is divided. Compound dressings are divided into three types. Tissues. Wound dressing, standard dressing. Tissues, wound dressing, standard dressing. So, for tissues, the examples for your tissues type of compound dressings are gauze and cotton tissue, combination of gauze and cotton, gauze and cellulose wadding tissue, combination of gauze and cellulose wadding, gauze and capsicum cotton tissue, combination of gauze and capsicum cotton. Okay. Next category is wound dressing, perforated plastic wound dressing. Examples are perforated plastic wound dressing. Next example, waterproof plastic wound dressing. Next example is waterproof microporous wound dressing. Next, standard dressing. These standard dressings have been given by a particular number. Okay, you need to call the standard dressing by number. So, number 7, it is related to plain lint finger dressing. Number 8, medium plain lint dressing. Number 9, large plain lint dressing. Number 9, large plain lint dressing. Number 10, medicated lint finger dressing. Number 11, medium medicated lint dressing. Number 12, large medicated lint dressing. Number 13, small plain wound dressing. Number 14, medium plain wound dressing. Number 15, large plain wound dressing. Number 16, eye pad with bandage. These are different types of compound dressings and their classifications along with the. Thank you everyone for your patience towards the session. Please like, share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much.